The Celtic Exchange, a fresh insight on Celtic Football Club.
Irishman Johnny Kenny and Australian Riley McGree have become the latest recruits to sign up for the Ange Revolution this week. With a bit of luck, we'll all be allowed back into Celtic Park next Monday to see them as they and our new stars from Japan look to step out in the hoops for the very first time. This is episode 52 of the Celtic Exchange Weekly. This is Tino, and this week I'm joined by Miff and James to cover all things Celtic. Miff, the dogs keep barking and the signings keep coming. What do you make of the latest developments?
Hello Tino, hello James, hello folks. Quite surprising. We're not very renowned for for January, our plentiful January business, but seems we're really going for it. Been multiple links with the club, and it doesn't seem there's been a lot of links with players going the other way either, which is quite surprising. So, quite surprised, but pleasantly surprised, I have to say. I'm pretty happy with it, if I'm being honest.
Yeah. James, welcome back for your first show of 2022. Are you pleased with how Celtic have gone about their business so far?
Very professional. You have to say they've been planning this for 3-4 months, I would say. And it's a refresh. You know, things like your Soro's going out, Shaw going on loan, as well as the guys coming in. Very exciting stuff. And it's all positive Ange Ball football type signings. Not a lot at the back. It's all about the going forward. So, yeah, I've been very impressed. And how Michael Nicholson managed to get the debit card, I'll never know.
Business at the back, party at the front seems to be Ange's approach. So we'll get to that in a wee bit. So we spent a good deal of time last week on the new guys from Japan, particularly Maeda and Ideguchi. They spoke to the media at Lennox Town for the first time last week, so we're not going to go over any old ground there. Hatate, however, he arrived a bit later and he was finally unveiled on Saturday. Ange's ended any speculation about, you know, the left-back suggestion. He said he signed here as an attacking midfielder. He'll be wearing the number 41 shirt, last worn notably by current coach John Kennedy, and should provide strong competition for Turnbull and Rogic. James, are you excited to see him step into the midfield, and do you think he goes right in?
It depends what else happens. You know, McCree's to possibly heard just before we came on here that he might well have just signed, so he's attacking midfielder as well. Ideguchi's in there as more of your kind of holding. There's other options already at the club, so I think this is just the depth that Ange needs in the midfield, because it's such a high intensity game. So there's going to be rotation within that, and he has to be replacing like for like, unlike we saw at Leverkusen, where it was replacing like with much, much poorer.
Yeah, definitely. Miff, Hatate comes with a big reputation. He's won the J-League the last two seasons with Kawasaki Frontale. We're getting him at a good time in his career, 24 years of age.
Yeah, well, again, it's it kind of bucks the trend of how we normally sign players, because we either sign projects or, it tends to be players coming in maybe more towards the end of their career. I like the fact that we're signing someone, you know, like you say, still probably reached their peak, but has already played a lot of times and won things. I think that's really, really important. James kind of referenced the point there, which I think is a really important one, there seems to be a certain type of player we're signing. You know, if you look in the summer, could you have said that? I know Ange said that he signed Starfield, but I still don't believe him. You know, the intensity that Ange wants to play with, it's athletic, agile type players that we seem to be signing. That's the bit that excites me the most. There's a plan. There's a definite plan here. And at least we can say if it doesn't work, we did back your manager.
Yeah, I think so. It is interesting. There's no doubt. So, you know, we'll get in a second about the newest signings, but there's five signings that have come in here, and maybe take the young Irishman out of the equation, certainly four, three Japanese and one Australian. It's Ange-centric, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all football and it's all going forward. It's got to be exciting for any fan when you're playing exciting football already and then your manager goes out and signs four attacking type players, you know, so looking forward to it.
It's ironic that we're going to play Hibs next Monday, because it looks like we're going to set up with a famous five forward line and just go like some sort of 2-3-5 formation to accommodate these guys. So to touch on the new signing, so also confirmed on Saturday was our fourth signing of the window in the shape of young Irishman Johnny Kenny. 18-year-old striker arriving from Sligo Rovers, League of Ireland. A fee is believed to be around about £150,000. 2021 was his breakthrough season and he scored 11 times and I think he's assisted once or twice, depending on where you get your info. He signed in a 5-year deal as well, and it's an interesting continuation of that pattern. But Miff, obviously we don't have too much info on him just yet. He's not officially been unveiled, but do you see him as a squad player or a development player, or where do you see him fitting in?
Well, it seems to me he's going to be a development player. Excuse me, sorry, we frog in my throat today. I don't know what's happening. Nervous, obviously, with the camera here. Dawson was similar as well, because we brought him in the summer, went into the B squad. We signed, is it Lassen as well, for Watford? He's went into the B squad. It seems we are purchasing, you know, decent young prospects with a view to develop them and bring them on into the first team. So if we're purchasing good young talent, I'm all for it. I seen some footage of Kenny. He looks very mobile, I have to say. He looks like a bit of a buzz bomb up front. So here's hoping that he can come in. I mean, Scales having made a very similar move. I think he really does look the part, and it will only get better with more games and the more he kind of the more he features for Ange. So it would be nice to think that Kenny would have a similar type impact, where he would at least be involved in and around the first team squad. But I still think there's more to come in January in terms of bolstering the front line. I did say that last week, and I see just when you speak about Hibs, I saw a fairly persistent link with Martin Boyle through the week as well, which I find strange based on who we've signed.
Mm-hmm. I think so as well. I've never thought we were going to sign Boyle. The latest tonight, actually, I heard as I was coming in, was that they've knocked back $2.5 million from a Saudi Arabian club, and they just seem to be doing the rounds with Martin Boyle and try to get what they can you know, bargaining with him. But I don't think he's a right fit. I think at $3 million, when you see what we can get from Japan and other territories, I don't think we should be spending that money on Boyle, but we'll see what plays out. James, just, you know, back to Johnny Kenny. As Miff said, obviously we've got links there, and we've got, you know, strong connections as a club with Ireland. We've also got Scales that's now come in. Is he the kind of player that we should always be signing, you know, the best young talent from that league, you know, as much as we can, in terms of sometimes we'll have competition from the Premier League and that's tough to deal with, but when and where we can, should we be bringing in these young prospects?
Yeah, as long as we can show them a pathway. You know, there's a good friend of ours, Graham, you'll know, from Dublin. He's a big Bose fan, knows a lot more about League of Ireland than I would, and he said, just almost quote what you said there, he said exactly the kind of player we should be signing. So if we got guys like that and we can show them the path, and, you know, we're starting to see that with multiple players, I think that's always been a part of Celtic, and it really frayed, that line between youth and first team really frayed over the last few years. And I think Ange is starting to bolster that again. So as long as they pass there, yeah, get them in.
I seen a guy sniping when he signed, he quote tweeted the signing and said, you know, I just hope Celtic don't ruin another young Irishman's career. And it was like, well, you know, if you're good enough, you will make it through. There's a couple of guys, whether it's Jonathan Afolabi or Lee O'Connor and stuff, who probably aren't going to make it to Celtic, but I would argue that's because they just don't have the ability or the talent. You know, I might be proven wrong in that, but if you're good enough, you make it, and there's no doubt that Ange will give these young guys a chance, so maybe less so under the guys like Lennon, maybe Rodgers. I think Ange will bring a guy in, give him every chance to show what he's worth, and if you're good enough, you'll play.
Well, yeah. I think based on the weekend, with regards to a corner, I know Ross Doohan's there as well, but a corner and Doohan seem to receive fairly decent praise for the Tranmere fans at the weekend, so sometimes players just find their level. If that's the level that a corner's at, then so be it. But he's been at Man United, he's been at Celtic. Maybe it's just a case of him getting some experience and then coming back in and joining the squad. But I think, you know, based on the chats we were having in the summer, we would have probably had him starting before Ralston, just purely on the basis that he wasn't Tony Ralston. It just shows you though, that it can happen. Maybe he'll progress for being out on loan another season.
Yeah. O'Connor did play down in Wales. I think he played against Sheffield Wednesday and maybe in the game against Charlton, was it?
I think he played against Preston as well.
Yeah. So anyway, I think you're right. I think he may have found his level. But in terms of Kenny, you're right, James. So Graham over in Dublin, I think he described him as an excellent prospect, very impressive, and definitely the kind of guy we should be signing. His squad number's yet to be confirmed, and I suppose that'll tell us if he's signed for first team or not. He signs off his tweets at the moment with JK24, so maybe that's what he's looking for. We don't currently have a 24, so we'll see how that plays out. But yeah, it very much remains to be seen whether he is development team or first team. Somebody who should certainly be first team, you know, if all's confirmed with the signing, is Riley McGree. So breaking news today is that 23-year-old Australian Riley McGree is signing from Charlotte FC in the MLS for a fee of around about $3 million. You're not paying that to stick him in the B team with those guys. He spent the last year and a bit at Birmingham City in the Championship. His stats are a bit sketchy. I think he's only got a couple of assists, you know, maybe 13 appearances, something like that. But he's a guy that's very well known to Ange. I think Ange gave him his first call-up in 2017. I don't think he featured him in the team that played at that time, but he brought him in to train and get a good look at him. So he clearly knows him very well. The suggestion is also that Ange got involved personally to make sure this deal goes over the line. So if I'd mentioned earlier on, you're obviously a bit of a championship aficionado at times, but do you know much about McGree, or is it a bit new to you as well?
No, he's not somebody, I know he'd spent a bit of time at Birmingham, but he's not somebody that came across my radar, for want of a better expression. However, again, I think it just follows that theme that we've already discussed, in that Ange has been involved in the signing and is someone that Ange wants. So based on what we're seeing so far, that's got to be good enough for us. Mm-hmm. I would say, given he's got history with him, given he knows the player well and he thinks he can come in and do a job for us, then I'm happy enough with that. My question would be, we saw Soro looking likely to leave and Shaw going out on loan, still with the signings that we've made, we would still seem, as it stands, a bit bloated in the central midfield area. So my question would be, who's going to move on? I had heard a rumour, purely just a rumour, that Turnbull was potentially going to West Ham. I would doubt that, given how much he's featured under Ange. I don't think he would be the one to go. Mm-hmm. But it does beg a question. We'll probably need to make room somewhere.
I think we definitely do, because the last thing you want to any club, you've heard the rumblings at Man United, you know, it's a broken club and there's so much politics and so many issues. But they've got so many guys that are hanging around that are just not going to feature. You know, they've got Martial wants out, Pogba's doing Pogba things. You know, you get Matic. This isn't a Man U thing, but you know, you've got all these guys that believe in themselves, they think they're talents, and they're just not playing. Celtic are going to end up with a similar position if you've got guys like Ajeti and Soro and some other guys that you've mentioned there, Miff. And I don't think it makes for a good environment at Lennox Town if they are hanging around on the fringes knowing that they're not going to feature. So there's a job to be done by Ange and whoever else, James, in terms of moving guys out at this window.
Yeah, I don't think there's any doubt those moves are at play. It's just a financial question. So if they can move those guys on and find the right deals, they will move on. And if the deals aren't quite right, they won't. So it's a matter of asking the Celtic board and the Celtic finance how much cloth you want to cut here to make space. But I don't think there's any doubt that, you know, every Celtic fan and everyone at Celtic knows that these guys aren't quite going to fit.
Yeah, I think so. I wonder if Barkas is up there at Lennox Town causing chaos, Miff. Falling out everybody.
Ah, can he? Feeling
guys goes at the pool
just,
table.
I just don't think he could be bothered.
too much effort.
I just don't think he'd be bothered.
Yeah. To go back to Riley McGree, so he's a left-footed attacking midfielder. He's been capped 7 times by Australia. And like Hatate, he should provide that competition for Turnbull and for Rogic. So as you say, Miff, it's great to have options, but you just don't want to have too many options, do you? Because it can lead to a bit of unrest.
Well, it's a fine balance, but like we know from certain games this season, when you've looked at the bench, it's been Soro, Shaw, Uragidi that have been options that have had to come off it. So I think what Ange is trying to do is just eliminate that, so that each time he's naming a squad, he's got that plan B, plan C, whatever it is, to go to. I think he's been fairly restricted this season in terms of the depth of the squad.
Definitely.
Another name to mention in there, I know we spoke about him at length last week's McCarthy. Where does he fit in with us as well? You know, to me, there's just, now that we've got clearly Ange's players in, it's raising a lot more questions around other players in the squad and where their future lies.
Yeah. Miff, you talked about guys finding their level, you know, talking specifically at the time about Leo O'Connell there. O'Connell.
What's she need?
Exactly. Is that where Ewan Henderson's found himself? So he's now moved out to Hibs. He was obviously, you know, well-respected, well-thought of within the academy. We know all about his brother Liam, who's forged out a good career in Serie A now. And I think a lot of folk were very hopeful that Henderson was going to make it. Now, you can't please all the people all the time. That now that he's moved on and we are starting to, you know, move on some kind of bloated players. He's not a bloated player. I've got that all wrong. That's fine.
I was going to say that. Bloated squad. But harsh. Ewan Henderson.
We've moved him on from a bloated squad and he's over to Hibs now. I think it's fine. I think it's a move that suits all parties. He's initially on loan. It'll become a permanent deal in the summer and he goes with everyone's best wishes. You've then got other folk kicking up on Twitter saying, this is a disgrace. Young guys aren't getting a chance. But you only have to look at the first team just now, or the first team squad, to see, you know, McGregor and Forrest and Welsh and Mikey Johnson and Montgomery and various other guys, Dane Murray around the squad, Owen Moffat. Loads of guys do get their chance at Celtic, and at that point it's over to them to prove themselves. I think Henderson's been unlucky that he's come around at Celtic at a time when the midfield is jam-packed with decent players, but I think it's just the right move.
I mean, with regards to Henderson, he was in and around the squad when Rodgers was there. He was actually starting a few games, and then after Rodgers left, he just seemed to completely fall out of contention. Now that can be for different reasons. He went out on loan. By all accounts, he didn't exactly set the heather on fire. I think it was Dunfermline he went to on loan.
He did.
So it's just one of those things. I don't think Henderson ever actually let us down. I think he was always fairly impressive when he played in the first team. But like you say, if you look at it and you've been at Celtic or in and around the first team squad for 3-4 years and you can still count one hand the amount of times you've started the game, you're probably getting the vibe that your future does lie elsewhere. Yeah. Albeit that I thought especially after Betis had enough of an impact where he might have got a wee bit more game time, but he didn't. That in itself tells you a story. I think he maybe just lacked a wee yard of pace or a bit of dynamism to get about the park for Ange. That's the bit for me. He was certainly skillful enough. Probably a bit like his brother, to be honest. I mean, Liam Henderson was a cracking player. He actually scored on Sunday.
He scored
for Empoli on Sunday. Gave away a penalty then, scored the goal.
I would say there's more to it than just ability. He's a talented player, but in Ange's first refresh here, well, he'll also be doing the same attitudinally. Where are these players at? You know, not just in terms of are they professional, did they turn up? Are they chasing down when they lose the ball? All of these things come into Ange's thinking. It's not just can you play football, can you play my football, and are you showing up with the attitude that I need?
Yeah.
And that might be part of it.
Maybe. I mean, I don't think there's anything to suggest he's not got a good attitude as not a kid, but he might not
be. The Harry and the chasing down.
The other thing is, Miff, there's, you know, he's maybe now 3 or 4 Celtic managers in who have all had a look. And with all due respect, I do think he's a talent, but they've maybe just decided that he's not enough of a talent to move through. And listen, there's other guys that, you know, move on to Celtic and forge out good careers, and I wish him all the best, but I just don't think he's the fit at this moment in time. Another guy that falls into that bracket, certainly right now, is Liam Shaw. So he's joined Motherwell on loan. And I actually think this is a move that Celtic should be making. Mm-hmm. Get him out, you know, get Urigiri out in a positive way to go and learn their trade, play 90 minutes week in, week out, and then come back to us in the summer as better players.
Well, first of all, I think he came to the town and was absolutely blown away by how, you know, the surroundings. It was
in the ML postcode area.
Pretty special, ML1, pretty special.
Yeah, a lot of good guys up there.
So, listen, don't need to tell me that. Shaw is the classic case of someone that just has to play games. I think you've seen enough with him and Urigiri that there's something there to work with. You just need games, go out and play. And I think Mother will be a good... I think Alexander spoke really well of him, actually, when he signed him. So, no, I'll be interested to see how that goes.
Yeah. You were talking about Liam Henderson in Italian football. The suggestion is that we've knocked back a bit of $1.5 million from Udinese for Stephen Welsh. So, 21-year-old centre-half, obviously, we all know him pretty well by now. What do you think of that? I think that one, it's split opinion on Twitter, particularly about whether we should be accepting that, but they're not. For me, no, absolutely not. He's certainly... third choice centre half right now. We'll see what happens with Julian, but why would you develop a guy like that, get him into the first team and punt him for quite a paltry amount as well?
And he's also developing, he's going through his development, he's just been rushed into the squad, you know, maybe earlier than Celtic would have wanted. So I see enough in Welsh that there's something there, and I wouldn't want to see him leaving the club while he's still in that development phase. If somebody wanted to come in and be stupid and give us 12 rising to 16 million for a guy who doesn't play football, then maybe Catty. Maybe, but not at this stage. $1.5 million, that's just ridiculous. And what they're doing is they're trying to snap up players that they can then punt on to other leagues for, you know, profit. It's a reasonable model, but that's not going to fly.
You've seen it actually with the left back, Aaron Hickey. He's come in there, he's doing a decent job, and it looks like he might kick on to different levels. Villa were linked with him and various other sides. So maybe, you know, Italian teams are seeing some good young talent here in Scotland, thinking they can develop them and kick them on at another time. I mean, what do you think, Miff? Where do you stand on Stephen Welsh?
I wouldn't be selling him. I think he's got a role to play. What would it cost us to replace him? Mm. Would be another question. If you take $1.5 million in from somebody that's, you know, kind of settled and in the squad, at least double, I would say, to replace him. So no, it just doesn't make any sense to me. The actual inquiry doesn't make a lot of sense to me, to be perfectly honest with you. Obviously, there's a model behind it that the Italian clubs have maybe sought out, but because I know they've got a link with Watford as well. Udinese, I think they're the same ownership. Okay. But for me, no, I would keep him. I've seen a lot of people thinking, I've seen one comment saying we need to get better at knowing when to sell, but selling a 21-year-old for $1.5 million that's still part of the squad, for me, that's just a big no.
Yeah, I agree with that. Don't think it makes much sense at this moment in time. So I've picked up on the fact that we've actually used 33 players so far this season, a lot of bodies. And the new signings, so five new signings, as well as the potential return of Julian and Karol Moko Dembele, could take that up to 40 players very easily. That is a lot of guys to go through in any season of football. So James always knew this was going to be a season of transition for Ange, but it's a lot of bodies to be in and around the first team squad, isn't it?
Yeah, but I think this points to something you said earlier on about, you know, potentially creating unrest. That for me isn't inevitable. It's about communication and saying to players on the way in, as I'm sure McCree's been told on the way in, that we need a lot of players for this midfield because the way we play football, and it'll be during the game and it'll be during the season, we'll need that level of depth. So yeah, 40 is, you know, maybe too many, but we know there's going to be bodies going out the other side of that as well. And bear in mind that when Ange, you know, started this journey, he was using guys, you know, no one's mentioning Dane Murray just now, you know, he played a serious part in getting the season off to a start. So that'll be in your number of 33 as well. So there's guys that will have played and all dropped back down to develop, much as Dawson will, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, you've also got Ryan Christie and Edward in the mix.
Of course.
Joey Dawson, as you mentioned, so yeah. Owen Moffat.
Barkas.
I think it just highlights the scale of the job that Ange inherited, because he's had to go through all those players at times. You know, the fact that Dawson's even featured, or Moffat's even featured, has been down to just how riddled with injuries we've been. Yeah. And again, you can argue that's a byproduct of the way Ange's training them to play the way that he wants them to play. So that number of players, if Ange decides we need 10 midfielders, we need 10 midfielders. That's the way it is, lads.
I think that's it. And I think it just, as you say, if it just shows how big the overhaul has been for Ange, and that in itself, it's no mean feat, is it, to juggle those players. So as I say, we're approaching potentially using 40 guys, but by and large, he's had to do what he's had to do, you know, on an almost weekly basis. He's had to shuffle the pack at different times, and I suppose it shows his skill in doing so and still getting us to the position where we're seriously fighting for the league and having already, you know, picked up the first trophy.
Seriously fighting and putting ourselves in a stronger position to achieve that. You know, trophies in the trophy room, overhauled a full squad, playing football that we all want to see. I think the job he's done so far is nothing short of remarkable, and it's the very start of what we're going to get to see.
Before we move on to our next section, I just want to give a quick word of thanks to all those who have continued to support and listen to the podcast in their numbers in recent weeks and months. The response has been amazing, and it's really appreciated by everyone here at the show. We also launched our very first episode on YouTube last week, and again, the response has been great. So thanks genuinely to everyone who's viewed, commented and subscribed to the page there. If you like what we do here at the Celtic Exchange and want to offer a small bit of support, then could we ask you to take the following very small steps, and I promise it'll only take you a couple of minutes of your time. So if you listen to the podcast on Apple, Spotify, Google Podcasts or any other podcast platform, can I ask you to either subscribe or follow us there and to leave a short 5-star review if possible. Alternatively, if you prefer to watch us on YouTube and with Housewife's favourite miff taking centre stage, then why wouldn't you? Please subscribe to the YouTube page, like this episode, and of course, let us know any comments or feedback in the comments section. That's it, quick and easy, and it really goes a long way to helping us do what we do. So back to the show. There's obviously, sorry, Miff, something you want to say?
Did I just do my first bit of acting now? I think I did. Did we get it in camera?
That couldn't be your first.
Fucking hell, man.
Surely you weren't acting there.
Cheers, lads.
So, again, as is always the case at this time of year or any sort of transfer window, we continue to be linked with numerous names, and, you know, some will come to fruition and some definitely won't. Are you hearing any yourself? Have you guys got anything that you've heard of?
The Iranian link, yeah. Although that then led me to look, and I seen that on the 7th of December, there was an article saying that we'd scouted three players for Iran, one of which was a striker, Jihadi, or I don't know.
Gayedi. So, the guy that's been linked just now, good job you're on the case, Miff. So, it's Iranian international forward, Mehdi Gayedi, 23 years of age.
Gayedi.
He currently plays with Shabab Al-Ali in the United Arab Emirates Pro League. His Wikipedia page has already been updated. Some very creative and bored people out there. I'm not sure how accurate this is, but we'll run through it. So, Mehdi Francis Patrick Gayedi, born 5th December 98, is an Iranian professional footballer who plays as a left winger for Sinj Premiership club Celtic and the Iran national team. On January 10th, it was reported that Celtic were interested in signing the player. with Ange Postecoglou and Michael the Money Man Nicholson getting the deal over the line for a fee of £1,888 plus Chris Commons. Gaeta was quoted as saying when announced for the Hoops, "I grew up watching Celtic. The likes of Stefan Shepovic, Chifche and Carlton Cole have inspired me to become the player I am today." On the 30th of February 2022, he was arrested for using PSWATP in place of a full stop. In 1967, he was forced to retire after sustaining career-ending injuries from a stray Neil Lennon air quote. I don't know how much of that is accurate or not, Miff, but it just shows there's a lot of people out there with a lot of time in
their
hands.
I was going to say that, aye, so obviously lads have got a bad time in their hands, but I'd seen the article for the 7th of December. I wish to God I had actually remembered the three names, but Guidi was one of them. And I think it just, again, it goes to show we are looking south of the equator for players. Angie's obviously got a knowledge of Asian football from his time as Australian national coach. So if that taps us into yet another market that we've not had any exposure to, then great. But the danger is that, you know, not everybody's got to be a Kyle Go, as I said last week, and that... not even just the impact he's had, the way that he's clearly obviously settled as well. Mm-hmm. You know, it's fairly unprecedented. So I think this is the most active January there's been in, like, I think since Mowbray was manager.
It makes sense.
We brought in quite a few, brought in Keane and Cameron, players like that at that time. This is different. It's a really targeted approach. It's obviously been worked on behind the scenes. But it will just be interesting come the end of January what the squad's going to look like, because it could even look just completely different.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean, you know, there's a couple of other links here at the moment out with some of the usual stuff we're hearing. Martin Boyle's an ongoing link. As I say, I don't think that'll happen, but we'll see. The other one doing the rounds today is 24-year-old Alfred Gudmundsson, mm-hmm. an Icelandic international winger. He's currently at AZ Alkmaar. Don't know if he played against us or not. I think he did.
I think he's out of contract in the summer.
I think you're right with that. He was previously at PSV. I think he's picked up 20 odd caps for Iceland, so he must be a decent player. But I suppose my point on these various links, in addition to who we've already signed, we're not been linked with many guys who aren't wingers or forwards, and that's exciting, that's great, but you need to close the door at the back as well, don't you?
Six guys in the left wing, I'm all for it.
Mm-hmm. We spoke last week, James, we spoke to Sinky and asked Miff as well, you know, where the priorities were. Myself and Sinky certainly agreed that left back was still a gap for us. So where do you stand on that?
Even a couple of days ago, I'd completely agree with that. But just as you're starting to see what Ange is doing this window, he's kind of saying what we've got at the back is what we've got at the back. It's good enough for the way I play football. We've got cover. I think skills as a player, by the way, I think he's our number one left back. Taylor's great cover. You've got Juranovic and Ralston on the right. There's a bit of a, you know, body of players to play centre half. And Ange's probably looking at it going, yeah, we'll get by with that. So why don't I focus my budget on where I really want to be, which is playing football?
Yeah. Matt, are you looking forward to seeing your first 9-5 scoreline for Celtic? Which is definitely on the post.
I say, looks like it's going that way. I'm just intrigued. As you can probably tell, I don't really quite know what to make it. It's just how it's going to play out, because naturally we're not going to sign everybody we've been linked with. But to this point, we pretty much have signed everybody we've been linked with in January. So squad overhaul. Ange never really get the time to do it in August or July, so he's making up for lost time. The danger is that the state of flux kind of ruptures the harmony in the squad, because there's people coming in, people going out. But we just need to wait and see. It's work that was needing done, and I think I made mention of this previously as well. Very un-Celtic like to do business in January, but if we're doing business in January with an eye to pre-season and being fully prepared for the qualifiers, then it's a nice change of pace, it's a nice change of strategy, and I'm all for it.
I think as a fan base we've been crying out for it, because too often over the years we haven't prioritised Champions League qualification. We wait till it comes around in summer, we then bemoan the fact that we have these qualifiers so soon and we can't sign guys and we can't prepare. So why wouldn't you prepare in January for, you know, all the riches that the Champions League can offer, you know, touch wood if we get there and all that. It just makes perfect sense. Start this in January, bed these guys in, particularly if they're coming from Asia and different territories. Let them get used to Glasgow, let them get used to Ange, let them get used to the football, and it'll stand us in good stead for the qualifiers, unless we qualify immediately, of course, through winning the league.
Yeah, it's definitely an opportunity.
Listen, James, we've all got the same 24 hours in a day. It's what we do.
That's what
counts.
I keep hearing these days, aye? Yeah. But no, I think it is Celtic, you know, starting to look like a professional scouting, transfer operation, squad operation. And we've needed that for a long time. And I don't doubt that Rodgers has that in his locker. I think he was blocked from doing it the way he wanted to do that. I think that's pretty common knowledge. I think Lennon came in and it wasn't the focus. He wasn't getting the final say. And I just came in and said, if I'm going to play the players, I'm signing the players. And as much as in the summer, he maybe didn't do all of those, this window he definitely is.
Yeah, I mean, I think just not necessarily in a good way. I understand it's, you know, do the jobs that's required right now. But at the moment, Ange is, you know, first team manager, head of recruitment, head of scouting, head of team harmony, head of everything. You kind of half expect him to appear in the canteen serving the chips, Miff. You know, where does it stop? He's got too much to do.
And he's the best at all of them. That's aye. Well, I just think that seems to be his nature. I think he's going to live or die by his decisions and the way that he wants the club to be run, how he sees fit. Again, we were crying out for that this time last year. We just felt so rudderless. It was announced, I think, that Lawwell was leaving, and we were wondering what sort of overhaul was going to be done. Now it looks like we've just got to bring in one guy to do the lot. Yeah. But I think that it'll be staggered over time that Ange will get the sort of foundations and the people in that he trusts. Bear in mind that he has come over here himself, you know, without a backroom team. So I think that's just sort of steadily building, and we should, I would imagine, see developments in that over the coming months.
Yeah, I mean, James, you picked up on a good podcast episode this week, and it's maybe a timely moment in the show to talk about that. So it was an episode with Ange from a podcast called Masterminds Podcast with a fella called Anthony Hudson, if I've got that right. It was from back in March 2020, but do you want to let us know any wee kind of nuggets that you've picked up on from that one?
Yeah, I suppose much props to JC16 for putting us onto that. She was the one that kind of sent it across.
Yeah.
Actually, an interesting guy himself, Anthony Hudson, a real kind of pursuit of excellence kind of guy. He's the assistant manager of USA, America. He used to manage New Zealand's team. He's been around the game a long time. He's close to Ange's journey. And this is just after Ange's won the league over in Japan. So one of the really important points I took from it was Ange talking about, and this is 2 years before, or a year before Celtic was even on the radar. He spoke about that backroom side of things, and he likes to come in where there's people there that don't know them, don't know him, don't know his ways, because they then challenge him more than someone. If he took someone with them, they would go, oh, that's Ange's thing, I'll just agree with that and go along, and you learn nothing from people who agree with you. So he wants your Kennedy, your McManus to say, why are you doing it that way? Tell us a bit more about that. I just thought it was something I'd never really thought of before. And I suppose a wider comment to the Scottish football media reporters, why have they not heard that podcast? Why have I heard that and they haven't? Because they're still asking questions about backroom.
Yeah, they possibly have, and they just have, you know, chose to ignore
just
it.
The narrative.
An interesting agenda. But yeah, it's interesting. I've listened to wee bits of it, and I'll listen to it in more detail. What we'll do is we'll link to this in the show notes. So it's called The Masterminds Podcast by Anthony Hudson, and it's an episode from March 2020. But just gives more of an insight into Ange, because we hear him a lot just now, or we certainly have done in the first 6 months of his time. And a lot of the time, in a fairly positive way, he's repeating himself, but it's just because he knows his systems and his methods and what he believes in, and he just reinforces that message. So it was good, just, you know, from that point of view, James, to hear something a wee bit different on Ange. So definitely want to check out. Moving forward, so obviously the excitement is building ahead of Monday of next week, and that's the return of football after about 3 and a bit weeks. Celtic will welcome Sean Maloney's Hibs to Celtic Park. Slightly conflicting newspaper reports at this moment in time, so we're recording here on Monday evening and we'll find out more tomorrow, I'm sure. But it's yet to be confirmed if full houses will be back in the Premier League. We'll wait for that confirmation. So, Miff, I mean, as we look to, you know, to hit the ground running and get back in a decent run of form, how important would it be to have those fans there for that?
Well, I think it's absolutely vital. I think it's been shown this season, the sort of bond that's grown between the fans and the players. So yeah, it's vitally important. You know, a full Celtic Park, again, something we referenced pre-season when we were talking about the upcoming season, is that a full Celtic Park back in the team will have a positive effect on the players, and it's proven to be the case this season. So yeah, it'll be vital, and I think everybody after a fairly you know, the festive period was dampened somewhat by the fact that the football stopped, you know, crowds were restricted. I think everybody will be really anxious just to get back and go and support their team, regardless of what team they support.
Yeah. James, in addition to obviously us as supporters hopefully getting back in, it's also huge for the new guys, isn't it? You know, I'm thinking of the three guys from Japan. Don't know if it's too soon for a Johnny Kenny and, you know, McGree. McGree, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Just sounds a bit unusual. Mark McGree's son. But it's huge for the new guys, isn't it? And it's a big reason why players signed for Celtic in the first place, to experience that full house, and hopefully they can get that next Monday.
Yeah, and it's McGree slightly accepted, but for the Japanese lads, they've had a wee bit of time to bond with the squad as well, so it's kind of perfect. They've got a bit of Ange's training under their belts, and then there's a full live game just right around the corner. Can't come quick enough for me. I think it was obviously a common sense thing that the winter break was brought forward, but it's time now. And, you know, listen, I'll get into the numbers and all that stuff, but hopefully, you know, we can get fans there.
Yeah, common sense for most people. Yeah, some people argued against the break, which is...
Common sense isn't that common.
Yeah, that's true. So, Matt, what kind of test can we expect from this, they're saying, new Hibs side under Maloney? They've been signing a lot of bodies, so obviously Ewan Henderson won't be eligible for it, given that we are still his parent club. But they've signed a few other guys. They've signed someone from Bodø/Glimt, I think.
Yes, and they signed Harry Clark from Arsenal on loan, who'd been at Ross County as well.
Yeah.
I think Maloney's getting in there and he's done fairly well first couple of games. You would expect that from any time I've heard him speak. He comes across quite well. He's good experience, obviously, being away with Belgium. So, good luck to him apart from Monday night.
Yeah.
It'll be a tough test, but we've shown this season we can take care of Hibs. It's just we need to apply that. Both teams, by the sounds of it, will have some new signings in their point as well. So, it's a really interesting game. Good game to hopefully welcome the fans back to it, and I'm really, really looking forward to it.
Yeah, so they're currently fifth in the table, James. They're behind the likes of Hearts and Motherwell, but they'll be looking to set down a marker during the second half of the season. I believe Paul McGinn and Ryan Portis are both suspended for this one. They're both first-choice defenders, so that's going to put them under pressure, considering the attacking intent Celtic will have, you know, in a home game.
Well, and it's interesting because any other manager, any other team coming to Parkhead would say, well, I've lost two of my first-choice defenders, so I'm going to go two hard banks of five, low block football, all that stuff. I can't see Maloney taking that on. I think his football philosophy, you know, having been a Celtic guy, is similar enough to Ange's in terms of he wants to play attractive football, which can obviously go against him without, you know, with a couple of players out and stuff like that. So a lot remains to be seen as to how that game is going to go. I don't think Maloney's going to come and defend. I think he's going to come and play football, which should play to our advantage.
Miff, always bet responsibly, but £2 correct score, 9-5 Celtic. Are you going for it?
Looks like it. Look, I'm all in.
Yeah.
Over 14.5 goals.
In terms of who will feature for Celtic, it's very, very hard to call. You know, for a time there, you could easily pick out the lineup and it was fairly settled. Now that's all been blown out the water in a good way. It'll likely be too early for guys like Julian. Obviously, he's back training and we'll see how he goes. There will be a bit of hope that Jota makes it. You know, I don't know if he featured in the training montage Celtic put out on Saturday, whether he's still, you know, having talks or whatever's going on, we don't know. But we'd be hopeful that he would be back. A fully fit Kyogo, of course, would be nice to see, as well as the excitement over the new guys, Miff. But, you know, could be a very interesting lineup.
Well, that's the thing. We just simply don't know. A lot of chat about Jota and Vickers being signed permanently, which would be welcomed by me, certainly. Mm-hmm. But we just don't know, and it's hard to tell because Kyogo was injured, Jota was injured. You don't really know what you're going to get, but that was the whole point of the signings. The signings were there to add depth to the squad so that you did have other options rather than it being left on Johnson, because it looked like the responsibility was weighing pretty heavily on Johnson. I think he's best used sporadically, certainly at this point in time, until he gets his confidence back. So I'd seen on one of the stills, I'd seen James Forrest training and sprinting alongside the rest of the team, which I thought was really good news.
Yeah.
But by the same token, I'm assuming by the signings and the links that we've had, that I'm not saying Ange doesn't fancy James Forrest, but he's probably thinking that he's not robust enough to kind of keep up with the regime.
Maybe.
Is how I'm looking at things, which is probably quite unfortunate given how regularly Forrest contributed to our success.
Yeah, I think Ange will certainly see James as a talent, but it's just whether he can rely on that. And I think that's why we're seeing so many forwards and wingers either brought in or continue to be linked with the club.
Yeah, and I kind of touched on earlier on about the kind of, you know, replacements and stuff. You're saying about, you know, Jota may or may not make it, and a month ago, Jota may or not making it means I'm going to get Johnson, which is a serious downgrade at the moment. Let's see if Johnson...
I know, son.
But let's see if Johnson can get out on that loan. And I really think he should get out on loan and play first team football, because then you're going, oh, Jota can't make it, but Maeda's there.
Yeah.
So this is what you're going to get in the fully fledged Ange team, is that the guy who doesn't make it is replaced by a guy who you're delighted to see in there. So you're only talking, you know, tiny degrees of quality change between them, up or down.
I think as well, Ange's system, you know, the intensity of it, it does rely on guys giving their tank for 50, 60 minutes. And in a good way then, you know, either putting the pot up themselves or Ange saying, right, he's done his shift, I now replace him with a guy of similar quality, and you just continue like that for the 90 minutes. Because at times we have flagged and we've not put games to bed. We've, you know, we've gone 2-0 up and then kind of flagged a wee bit and maybe finished 2 or 2-1. I think this system allows you to go 2-0 up, refresh things at, you know, the hour mark and finish 4-0 rather than, you know, just go over the line.
That would be nice, rather than nervously seeing out games. I see though that you've moved on to your next pet from Mikey to Big Chris.
Oh, aye.
Mikey is my number one, but I'm a fan of Julian yet. Julian,
the great pretender.
I really do feel his stock has risen with him being out the team rather than the his product effect on the park.
Yeah. I seen your snipey wee tweet.
Yep. I just think,
it doesn't go unnoticed.
I just think, again, when you talk about levels, I think he's a good player. I think he's got a part to play in the squad. But I don't think he is what everybody or a lot of fans seem to be making him out to be. There wasn't Aye. That evidence there prior to him getting injured.
I don't think he's brave enough to play Ange ball. And that's the big thing Ange looks for. And, you know, I've been critical of Starfelt. One thing you can't say is that he's not brave. You know, he keeps putting himself in there. He keeps taking the ball out of defence. Maybe he shouldn't. But he's certainly a brave enough guy with the talent he's got to keep on doing that. I don't think Julian's a brave player. I really don't.
Did you not see the way that he tackled that post against Dundee United?
If he was any better
the guy
a player,
would run through a post for you.
If he was any better a player, he wouldn't have had to do that. It was his lack of awareness that put himself in that position to hit that post. 100%.
Barkas is nonsense. That's what he done to keep us a clean sheet. I think we won that game 3-0 that day. And this is the thanks he gets. Guys like you throwing him under a bus.
It's just your pity. I think, let's see, is where I'm at with Julian. I'd love him to come in and, you know, be this completely different player. He's certainly, you know, he's the most expensive centre half we've ever signed, so I'm prepared to give him a chance, but I don't think it's the final answer.
Well, I think we need to look at him in two ways. Of course, his main job will always be to defend. He scored huge goals for Celtic, you know, the League Cup winner, whatever that was, 2020, 2019. 2019. And he scored against Lazio, the winner there, and a couple of other big goals. So yeah, you know, I think he's very capable defensively, but Ange is such a, you know, a forward-thinking manager that he'll be saying, where can I also utilise this guy? Not that we're going to kind of lump balls up, you know, and, you know, get him in the box and go like that, but if at times you're looking for something different from a corner, because listen, we're struggling at corners. We offer very little at the moment, set pieces and corners, there's nothing really there. He's clearly shown an eye for goal. So if he can, you know, take care of things defensively and add goals, it's a big asset.
Well, there's no point in having a 7-foot centre-half if you can't beat the first man for a corner.
Well, this is true. It all comes down to the delivery coming in. But I do think he's got a huge part to play. And listen, the good thing about this is we'll all be able to sit down in 4 or 5 months' time and look at the season and say, here's exactly how we fared. So him and Mikey Johnson
You are right out on a limb.
I said a while ago, bury me on a Mikey Johnson-shaped hill, but also a wee bit of Chris Julian shaping around it as well. Just to go back to the Hibs game in general, I mean, as I said, there's a lot of uncertainty as to what our lineup will be, and Hibs' lineup, I suppose. But would you lads be as bold to make a prediction at this stage, or is it just a very hard one to call?
Stick with the 9-5.
9-5's all round.
A prediction. You go first, James.
4-1. 4-1 Celtic. I think this is the reset to the football we were seeing early on against Dundee and St Mirren and stuff like that. They're going to be
plenty of goals.
Crazy tempo, yeah. Hard to live with.
I'll go 3-1 Celtic.
Yeah. I have to say, whether it's just, you know, the way it's landed with the 3-week break or whatever, I'm really quite excited, you know, touch wood and stuff, we get back to Celtic Park, but it's a real one to look forward to. Monday night football, floodlights, all the new signings, all the buzz are going back to it. We've not seen Ange in a few weeks. It'll be a real one to look forward
to. I've missed him.
Yeah.
I have missed him.
What about your wee fella? Is he excited?
Again, it's just a case of getting back to it. There's no really a time where you ever want to be without going to the football or going to see Celtic, especially this season when we've had a bit of renaissance for the nonsense the season before. So, I very much excited getting back to it. And even more so when you've made signs, you know, it's exciting.
Nice to see.
You just want to get back. You want to see how they're going to perform. You want to see what position they're going to play in, how the team's got to line up, all those things. It just adds to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. What I'm going to do now, just a very quick look ahead at what we've got in the remainder of January, because after that, the games really do come thick and fast. And it's actually quite an intense end to the month before that big game on the 2nd of January, unless
if
Celtic,
we feel like it.
Unless
if
Celtic we feel like play it. That card and, and we bump that fixture down the line. We'll play
you
if we want.
You'd only do that if you're playing 4-4 though.
Maybe so. So we've got Hibs, obviously, on Monday coming, 17th of January. Then it's Aloe on the Cup on Saturday. You going to that, Miff? The Indodrill Stadium?
I don't know.
Time will tell. Then we've got Hearts on the 26th at Tynecastle, and then Dundee United at Celtic Park on the 29th. So, I mean, that's three tough league games. Hibs, Hearts and Dundee United, you know, their teams have been there or thereabouts towards the, certainly the, you know, the top half, top six of the table. And every point's a prisoner, James. We can't afford to even draw any of those games. So you'd really be hoping that we get 9 points out of nine before that big game.
I mean, there's just, we've dropped the point that we can drop this season. There's no points available to drop now because we know how tight it's been. I think our competition for the league, I think they will drop points between now and the end of February, but we can't be looking over that fence. We've just got to keep doing what we do and win every game. There's no margin for error here.
Yeah, do you see it like that, Miff?
Again, I think it depends on events that have yet to happen in terms of January and what that will bring with movements in and out for both Celtic and Rangers. So it's just the way it's all set up is just really interesting. And this is what we wanted, this is what we hoped for, you know, at the start of the season, to be around this time of the year, making signings to bolster the squad, to still be in contention. And we are. We've got a trophy in the bag. I mean, it's reasons to be cheerful as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, I mean, from a fan's point of view, it's definitely, you know, stuff to be excited about. But James, you mentioned there, and I think you're pretty accurate, there's no room for error. You know, it's very tight margins. Do you think the players will be feeling that pressure, or how do you think Ange will approach that? Will he be calming them down, creating a siege mentality? How do you think it'll be looking internally?
That Andy Hudson podcast, he touched on it, and he's not a results guy, he's a performances guy. So what he'll be putting into the players is how you perform with your teammates and yourself, you know, how hard you work for your teammates, how we get through the game together. It won't be looking at, you've got to win this, and this. You know, and there'll be no talk of that at all. It'll be all about pure excellence within yourself.
Yeah, I do remember hearing Ange speaking about controlling the controllables. So he won't say, you need to go out there and get those 3 points. He'll break it down and say, as a defence, this is what you need to do, you know, as a forward line. And I've no doubt, Miff, that he'll be ensuring the guys are in a good, you know, headspace. You know, you, as much as anyone, can get quite uptight and quite nervous about results, and dare I say pessimistic, is that too harsh?
I don't know, just
You've been hurt before.
Can't be letting myself go too far. But in fairness, I think in recent years, you know, you win some, you lose some, that's fair enough. We had went so long under Rodgers, just consistently winning, that I think it makes, when you do lose the first one, whether that be trophy, you know, derby game, whatever it was, it stings that wee bit more.
Especially when it's self-inflicted.
Well, there is that. But more recently, it feels like we're the ones playing catch-up, so I'm just quite intrigued as to see how this develops. It's been a unique season this season, because we've had somebody come in just completely from left field. It's not like anything we've had before, and it's fresh and exciting. I'm just loving it.
Yeah, I'm exactly the same. I was speaking to one of the guys through our football on Saturday, and I was saying, without being too dramatic, it's as much as I've enjoyed following Celtic in a long time, you know, and we've had some brilliant seasons and great successes and nine in a row and quadruple trebles and, you know, other successes under Martin O'Neill and, you know, great European nights. This is really, really enjoyable.
I think that's as close to O'Neill's first season. That was a real, you know, that 6-2 game is something that's changed here.
Is it because I'm back in your life, lads? Is that what it is?
That is mainly what it is, man. Yeah. But there's some stuff going on.
That tingly feeling. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. Anil's first season, I would completely agree. It's
close to that.
Similar vibes to that in terms of just the excitement you're getting with every game coming.
Yeah, no doubt. James, as we start to wrap things up for today, have you any final thoughts ahead of this first game of the new year?
Ahead of the game? Yeah, just very, very excited for it. You know, we're talking about it there. Football's been away for a few weeks, getting it back, getting a Monday night under the lights, you know, Monday night football, I can't even think of when we last or if ever did, you know. That, the signings, Ange getting that team the way he wants it to be. There's a lot going on at Celtic just now and I'm loving every bit of it.
Did we know of a Monday night game against Hibs last season? When Nisbet scored in the last minute?
A post-Dubai thing. Well, here's a question. Regardless of
Dubai. Hey, we've done it. So well.
Loving it, man.
Out with that one. When would you last ever have found yourself at Celtic Park on a Monday, Miff?
Well, we weren't there, were we? Because
that's what I'm saying. We were, so aside from that, protesting, sack the board,
probably.
That's a good question.
When was Sinky down there throwing the fences last year? Was that a Monday? We need to get that.
Thursday.
Same question, I suppose, for yourself. Where are you at going into this first game of the season? The new year, sorry.
Just excited, but we're getting at the big build-up. It's got to be on each, no? It's got to be on each.
And there is that pessimism I spoke about.
I'm back. Yeah. I'm excited. It's just, I'm more excited, actually, to see what team lines up, as in the makeup of the starting 11. But it's going to be fresh, going to be exciting, and more implementation of the way Ange wants to play.
Yeah, definitely. An exciting time for Celtic, and it's one to look forward to. So after a break of just over 3 weeks, we'll finally get to see our new-look Celtic team take to the field on Monday night at Celtic Park. We might be there, we might not, but either way, it's the start of a crucial period for the team as they look to get back on track in the title race. Thanks to Miff and James for joining me in today's show, and of course, our thanks to you for tuning in. Please continue to support the show by liking, subscribing, and sharing this episode far and wide with your Celtic network. But in the meantime, and as always, thanks for listening.